by following Carol because she gives you a nice introduction to the DataNet program, and then I can just say yes, thank you for that. So we're the second of the 2 5-year grants which have been offered, and there are supposedly 3 more coming. Now I am going to talk about the Data Conservancy, but I'm going to do it sort of within the context of the sort of the larger concerns of why we study researchers. And for my purposes, my own research is because we're trying to inform the development of curation services and research libraries. And I will be talking about the Data Conservancy, but again, I'll be talking about that sort of as part of the trajectory of other studies that we've done and how we've been building our results over time. Well, I probably have to use this computer. This is going to trick me up. All right. So on this slide, I actually am trying to get my courage up to say curation is the future of research libraries, but I haven't gotten there yet. So I'm still saying, you know, curation and the future of research libraries.
Joyce won't give you any grants, you didn't do that.
But we know that, and we hear it constantly in the rhetoric from our funding agencies and our institutions, that data assets are vital for us to remain competitive as scientists, but also to be good stewards of the common good that we create through research. And I believe, and many others believe, that this is very much a natural extension for research libraries to move into this role to provide the basic mission of information resources to support current and future scholarship. But what we don't know yet is really what the model is going to be for this. And so I've been trying to collect people's ideas about this. So our Data Conservancy project is centered at Johns Hopkins University, and the dean at Johns Hopkins, Dean Taub, says, well, data centers are going to be the new library stacks. So that's sort of his view of how things are evolving. Our PI on the Data Conservancy has a very different view, that data are the new special collections, which I find a fascinating way of looking at it. So Saeed Chowdhury will say, you know, you walk into the rare book room and you've got a specialized librarian who holds your hand and gives you the resources, has deep knowledge of what's, you know, where it's come from, how it's been used, they give you special gloves to use it and all of that. You walk into a science library and there's not only no one there to help you with the data set, but there's no data set. So if you want help with the data set, there's nowhere to go. So this is in some ways a future that we hope to see. Another thing I like to emphasize, especially with students who are coming into our profession, is thinking about our role as library and information science as a meta science. So there's not that many fields out there where we're really responsible for all the disciplines in some respect. And again, that's been a major role of research libraries, is how do we serve and benefit and support and bring together resources across those domains. So how do we provide data resources to promote access across that broad landscape of information? So we've always brought in materials from many publishers, many disciplines, continuing to work across those lines. And I see this very consistent with, you know, long traditions of union catalogs and bibliographies and everything we've always done. Something that may be a little different from the day and age we have now of literature and research libraries is we do know that we keep materials across generations, but we've moved away from just-in-case collecting, but I do think we may move back towards that now, at least for some period, with data, because we are not going to know what's going to be valuable. And of course, this came up earlier. How do we figure that out? I also think, and this is something we've been working hard on at Illinois, if we're really going to be the kind of comprehensive and functioning infrastructures that our funding agencies are telling us that we need to be. We hear that, you know, this very lofty suggestion that we are going to build interdisciplinary, multi-scale, high-functioning science data centers. So we really believe that can't happen from on high, just research libraries and data centers, but that we have to have information managers and data curators in on the research team as well in the sciences. So we very much are moving towards that, and if I have time at the end, I'll talk a little bit about our training programs that really started thinking about how do we get curators and information professionals on the science teams. So I said I was going to give you a little background. I think I don't have time to really dwell on this, but one of the main points here is a research library, we know we're not going to be responsible for all data. We do know that we have to align ourselves with all the data, or at least in some way make things accessible, help scholars and scientists be aware of it. So we know we have to align or connect, if not house the data. And so as part of exploring this, we've really been involved with a number of studies to try to get a sense of what are these different organizing units that data is emerging in and how do we understand them. So one of our first studies was a local campus kind of an inventory that we thought would be very simple. It was a survey, similar questions to what we've seen earlier today about sharing and management of data, but ended up with a problem very early on that we were studying the faculty of the environment, which we found immediately were housed in 24 different units on the campus, and very hard to pool, compile, even a sample of who we needed to contact to do that. Another area that we've been looking at is data that's generated at a certain location or site that has high value because of the site, and there's a great demand to keep it somehow associated with that site. So a unique research-intensive location, in this case it's a national park in the U.S., but a cross-disciplinary data coming out of that site. The third study was very much one of these very disciplinary-oriented, the development of a resource collection. I will talk a little bit about that, and that was in the case of neuroscience. And here we have a disciplinary, a geographic, an institutional. Then the fourth sort of type of organization or structure is an institutional repository, which we're all familiar with, but many institutional repositories are just starting now to really understand what it means to bring in data, and that some of their processes aren't working very well for that. So this project, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on because Scott Brandt over there, we'll be talking about it tomorrow, but this is the Data Curation Profiles Project. But I will talk about a little bit in terms of the methods because we're bringing those methods forward into part of what we're doing in the Data Conservancy. And I just wanted to mention, it may seem like I'm leaving this out of this talk because I'm not going to talk that much about real functionality of data. But we do have other lines of research going on that I think are very related to that, and in particular extending the work that Alan Rainier and I published last year in Science about the notion of the concept of strategic reading, which of course is very resonates very nicely, and we build on some of the work at Cyber here to develop that. But I really...
We like you too.
yes, it's a mutual admiration society. I really believe that over time, actually very soon, we're going to need to support scientists reading data sets in a very similar way. How do they move quickly through bodies of data sets, aggregations of data sets, to do the kinds of work that they do now to read text? Okay, so I want to just briefly talk about this discipline-based repository study because it really is what launched the whole education and research set of projects that we have at this time. We were out studying high-impact information in neuroscience. It was piggybacked onto one of the human brain projects where they were field testing a literature-based discovery system in a range of neuroscience labs, very sort of bench scientist labs all the way up to big informatics institutes. And while we were out in field, after about 2 years in this three-year study, we really got hooked into observing and watching the kinds of tensions that were developing in the labs themselves where they were trying to manage their neuroscience and build data repositories. And so that's when we sort of started turning our attention to that in that project. And so we did study the development of one particular resource the data was coming in from cell biologists and microscopists, but also being used by modelers. And I think, just to briefly mention what some of the most important results of this that came out of this part of the study, this is Melissa Cragen's dissertation work that was sort of a spin-off from the larger project, was identifying the roles beyond archiving and access that these repositories are starting to play in the disciplines, that of actual registration of data, certification through the review process of some kind of quality, And then probably the most interesting for me is just the awareness function that it was having. So you know how we scan the literature and watch for, you know, current contents and that sort of thing. People scanning the data repositories to see the activity and where it's happening and what's being produced. So I think that's very interesting and something that as service providers we should be paying attention to. But of course, this project was very much looking at how do research collections, individual researchers, individual collections get moved into a community-based resource. And so it really is helping us understand that. The other thing we started in this project was trying to build up a new toolkit of methods for really working on looking at information use when that information is data, which was something fairly new to us at that time. So we started developing this sort of progressive critical materials approach to our data collection, learning about the data practices of scientists. So looking at particular data sets very closely, samples of data, and then working through not just the main researcher on a project, but also from the view of the data managers and others. So that led us, the next project was the Purdue project on the institutional repository curation requirements. And as I said, Scott will give you, probably a lot more detail on this. But basically, it was a two-year project extended to the third year. We're studying individual scientists' data production and workflows and perspectives on sharing. And I hope that he'll share some of the results that will complement some of the others we've seen already today. These are the disciplines. Again, the goal was to try to cover a range of disciplines to see what varying kinds of requirements, what a repository like that at Purdue would have to manage coming in from the different sciences. And then we did do across the two institutions a little deeper case study in a couple of domains, a little further coverage there. So we derived requirements for managed data sets in institutional repositories. Also, the data is very good for developing policies for archiving access for these particular researchers and research areas. And a very interesting dimension of this project was the participation of liaison librarians, both at Illinois and Purdue. We worked with them. They were part of the team helping to develop the profile approach, but then also became data sources for us to help us understand what their growing understanding was as people who support curation, but also their knowledge of their constituencies, their scientists back in their liaison roles. So this is the kind of data we collected. Most of the results are coming out of the very deep interview data, but those case studies developed across the institutions and in the focus groups with the liaison librarians were able to pull from that some, I think, very solid needs analysis of what the policies need to be for preservation and access, but also the development of this tool of the curation profile, which Scott will share with you, not only was a nice analytical tool for us to go through and pull from these data those specifics for the builders of the repositories and the keepers of the data, but also an instrument that others can use to go out in curatorial practice in libraries. And Scott has a new grant that's going to help them do more of that. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. That's up. So we'll hear about that. So I'll go on to the Data Conservancy now. This is the big five-year project, and we're one of the partners at Illinois. These are very large projects, so nobody gets to own them. But this one's different than all those other ones I mentioned in that this is a nationally scoped repository that lives in a research library. And the reason I'm so delighted to be involved is because I find it's very consistent with the sort of the way I see the world evolving. And so the main assertion of, up front in the proposal is that research libraries will be a core part of the emerging distributed network of data collections and services, understanding that it will be a very large distributed and emergent network. So our primary goal is to develop a curation strategy that's relatively comprehensive because it's a research library that serves all the disciplines, and not only to collect, organize, and validate data, but also similar to Data One, and I think one of the reasons maybe these two were funded is there is some overlap. While we have this broad orientation, We are also focusing on grand challenges related to climate change in some of the development, and so there'll be some very nice synergies with Data One. The other thing that we're doing very similar to Data One, and I think any project of this scale really needs to do, again, building from anew. We will have a preservation archive that will have lots of data in it at Johns Hopkins. But we're developing that based on exemplar projects, both in the sciences, but also building on digital library expertise of very large scale systems, along with very deep engagement with scientists. So here's the lineup. This is one of two slides. I'm not going to show the second one, but these are the main participants that Saeed's brought together. I think it's a very, very exciting and functional group of professionals, lots of domain scientists, but a very serious group of information and computer scientists, but also enterprise experts, librarians, and engineers. And I'll talk a little more about some of the roles of these particular players as we go ahead. So we're starting, our initial exemplar community is astronomy, and there's lots of reasons for this. One of the main ones being that the Library at Johns Hopkins has been involved and a partner with some of the large astronomy projects for a long time, so they feel a real commitment to seeing this go forward. And of course, NSF has invested a lot of money in astronomy data over the years, and like many other big data resources, there's been no sustainability plan or real avenue to move with these. So we have really important resources that have been developed over a 10-year period, like the National Virtual Observatory, the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, that have no real home and, of course, need a place to go. So that's sort of one of the first roles, first year, this is what we'll do. But the other thing about astronomy is, because they've been doing this for so long, it is a community, it is a very homogeneous community, so it's not necessarily the right exemplar for all that we need to do. But they have been very successful in building community data standards, practices, documenting that, and building services associated with their data repositories. So all of that's going fairly smoothly. They just don't have anywhere to put it. So what we're going to do is demonstrate that we can be a preservation archive, the utility of hosting those kinds of big resources, but then move on to expand our scope into the life sciences, earth sciences, and social sciences. And all of those sciences are, of course, important, as we saw in Data One, in a lot of the work in environmental science and climate change. So I will mention a few of our partners in a little more detail, just because, as I said, this is a network of networks, and we're building on exemplars, and many of our partners were chosen because they can play a very serious role in showing us the best way to do something, or the best way to bring this component together. So Marine Biological Lab is been deeply involved in development of Encyclopedia of Life, and so their role is primarily around ontology indexing for biological data and taxonomic organization. The group at the National Snow and Ice Data Center actually is a partner that I brought along because we've been working with them for several years now, because we really admire them as a very sophisticated curatorial data center. Ruth Ajour there is much a librarian as anything else, even though she has no training. But they have done more with collection level metadata and really thinking about users and use over the long term in what I think of as a perspective very similar to mine. So not only are we learning from them as very serious curators of data over the long term, they will also be one of our first test sites for a distant node that we will link to in the Data Conservancy. The National Center for Atmospheric Research, I'll bet a whole bunch of those atmospheric scientists that answered positively actually put their data here, and that's why, and they're very organized, and they're huge, and so it is very organized. But in fact, our work with them is more with certain scientists in NCAR that are working across disciplines, so on grand challenges that we can follow and take their lead and sort of learn what are the arrays of data that need to come in to really support that work. And then probably something that's of interest to people in this room, Cornell University is, of course, one of our partners, and they're playing many roles like Illinois, but they're promoting, they have the Data Star our platform for helping scholars sort of prepare their data for ingest. But I think more importantly, probably in year two, we'll really get a good start on trying to apply OAI ORE to linking research data to the ePrints archive. So we're really looking forward to moving ahead with that.
Perhaps you could, I know what it is, but I think I know what it is.
Open Archives Initiative Object Reuse and Exchange Standard?
Yeah.
Okay.
Good.
Keeps us honest. Yes. Yeah. So and Carl Lugosi, who's on this project.
You can look it up, people, students. You can look it up.
You know, I usually have a slide that we talk through that shows the OR. It's really fun. It has the little node and all those arrows, but I don't have it here. We can do that later if you want. I love talking through that slide. So some of the, I'm primarily involved in research and education. And I'll talk a little bit about the other research before we go on to my own. But the research group is quite large, and one of the things that we're working on is a data framework for scientific data around the concept of scientific observation. Although I'm sort of an outlier on that group, where I think that the observation itself is going to be a very hard thing to actually functionally use in a model. I'm more on the data set, data collection side, but we like to have a lot of debates about that.
Good, about 8 to 10 minutes, okay?
Very good, thank you. But so again, we're looking to adapt and examine and work along with the work that's already going on in this area. So of course, the National Virtual Observatory has done a lot of work in data models, but there's also a group out there, I don't know if any of you are familiar with them, the SONNET group, that's actually working now to try to harmonize 8 different ontologies related to scientific observation. So we're involved with that group. And then Alan Rainier, who's here, who's one of the local team leads, has a team at Illinois working on defining fundamental concepts. This came up earlier. I think that's what the question was. And we actually think it's vital that we all know what we're talking about when we say this data set is the same as that data set. And we can prove it. And we can have replicable science. But also, as people who preserve data, we have to have a target, and we have to know what that thing is. So what is it? Or is it a derivative of something else? It is a version of something else. If it is a version of what? All of that, we think, is fundamental to actually making a repository like this work, or for repositories to work with other, you know, link to it to others. So we're, you know, fast and furiously moving down that road. So of course, as we know, as Carol said, we have to accommodate many standards in earth science alone, atmospheric science, soil science, there's dozens, and yes, the typical scientists that we interact with, which have been hundreds now, typically know of none. So I'm surprised your numbers weren't even higher, and maybe they weren't telling quite the way it is. So I'm going to talk about our work here, but just to let you know, there's 3 different groups doing user requirements and user research in data conservancy. NCAR's doing the more usability task-based work. UCLA is doing a very deep ethnographic study of astronomy in the development of the Sloan Digital Sky Survey with all their historic email archives and everything. It's going to be really fascinating. So Chris Borgman's heading that up with Sharon Trawick, who's a historian of science at UCLA. But our work at Illinois is really focused on small science, where we think these are the real scientists that are going to be dependent on research libraries, and so we want to make sure they're not left behind in our flurry of working with astronomy. And our biggest research challenge is really to understand something that came up earlier this morning, is the reuse potentials of data. So how do we know what to select? How do we know we're making reasonable choices? And we do pretty much think we can't leave it up to the scientists to decide, because they're not very good judges, we've learned, of how someone else might use their data. So our work will be helping the infrastructure development team on curation requirements and understanding stages and characteristics of data, and then those communities. And I won't go through this because I know Scott will, but part of our analysis framework, again, is so that we can help the infrastructure development team really do a good job, is trying in our interactions and study of researchers, making sure we're capturing data that we consider a standard sort of profile of curation requirements, along with our other research questions that are going on. So again, sort of building on this progressive data collection. So my big goal now, my life goal now, is how to figure out the most efficient way to talk shop with scientists about their data, and really get, you know, find out what you really need to know from who you need to know, because it's not obvious and it's not trivial. And so, you know, how do you have the most efficient exchange you can? Just look at all those disciplines we have to cover. Look at all those communities that we have to understand. We can't slow down. We just got to move really as fast as we can, but trying to get really valid data. So I think a lot of what we developed in the Profiles project is helping that. We're you know, working with it, revising it somewhat, but we're working with pre-interview worksheets that get scientists focused directly on a kind of data for a project right away. So we're getting, you know, to that level immediately. Then we go in with semi-structured interviews afterwards, and often follow-ups where it looks lucrative, but quickly moving to the other people in the lab who actually know the nitty-gritty about what's happening with the data. So often postdocs, other staff members, data managers, where things about the stages, the versions, the standards, and the tools they're much more knowledgeable of, where the PI is going to know more about, you know, intellectual property and access and research context. So moving down here, using adapting one of the tools from the Profiles project, what we call the data deposit and sharing worksheet, and also making sure we get samples where people will let us and related documentation. How long do I have now?
About 5 minutes.
Oh, splendid. Okay. So we have two dimensions that we're trying to work through these data on to understand the researchers' practices, and also what, you know, the repository needs to do to support these data. And so one unit is the data itself, and I use the word sets in quotes because Alan wouldn't approve of me using the word data set in this way, because he's defining this very rigorously now. But basically, from the perspective of the data, what does the infrastructure development team need to know about a kind of data, or, you know, a set of data or a package of data that's very much aligned with how it's produced? You know, how do the researchers produce it, and how do they want to disseminate it? So this is things that will help us with workflows, with ingest, but also the kinds of services, policies on attribution and bargaining. Then our research is more focused directly. What we want to get out of it is more how we understand the data communities. What is a data community going forward? We don't think of them as the disciplines or even the data producers, but those communities that will come together around the interactions around data. So they're aligned with sort of the current, but more the future use of what we'll see. And this is very important for how we represent the data, the kinds of functionality we need to have for use. And I think this is a better way to inform selection and appraisal, retention, description, than relying on the producers. Again, this is something that's long-term, not something we can really do adequately now. So what kinds of communities are we talking about when we say these, you know, emerging communities around data? Well, the ones that seem to be mattering right now is meaningful social units for organization and use of data that have come out of, you know, our research so far. Are sort of the subdiscipline level, often even more than that, maybe a research area, but subdiscipline crossed with a kind of data, and I'm going to talk in a little bit detail about that in a minute. A specialized domain around a research problem, so that would be something like the group at NCAR looking at climate and weather hazards for urban areas, so that would be a problem, right? And then developers of something like the Neuroscience Resource Project. Again, that's not a coherent scientific group. It's a group that came together around developing this resource. And it's very different than these more emergent problem-based groups, but it's very important because they're building some of the most robust, high-functioning data centers right now. So those developers, which tend to be domain scientists, computer scientists, and others, are a different kind of community that we have to work with, and Carol alluded to that as well. So our core research challenge for my group is to try to predict and design for communities of users which will differ from the producers and change over time. And so just to give you a taste of what we're interested in, we're focusing on small science, as I said, but in particular systems-oriented small science, because I think we get the complexity there, the different kinds of data, and more bang for our buck and try to understanding the different types. So, This is from the producer perspective. One of our groups is systems geobiology, where they're producing what we've called, this is our description, site-specific time series data. And for them, this is a real package. This is a package that needs to stay together. It's spreadsheets that are actually calculations, not raw data. that have to do with measurements from rock water and microbial, all put together in one spreadsheet. But there's also microscopy images, annotated, there's photographs, some annotated, some not, but also maps. Volcanology is another group where we're actually bringing in large bodies of data and now working on actually digitizing it and bringing in. And the unit, data unit of meaning to them is called what we call a rock profile. So it includes the physical rock, which at this point in time does not have a repository, but will, we think. Thin sections of that rock that are then digitized, the chemical analyses of the rocks and the site that it came from, photographs and field notes. Okay, I think I can do that. Soil ecology, a little different, actual databases, they're a little further along even in their communal sort of resource development. They have a shared database where lots of soil measurements, temperature and acidity and that sort of thing come together with metadata. So very different units that we need to bring in and ingest, need to understand, need to be able to describe. But just to give you a sense of user communities, how they might not be the obvious, we know they're going to be interdisciplinary, but they're also not necessarily academic interdisciplinary. So we have in systems geobiology, we have the US Park Service that has a heavy dependency on these research and the data and actually a producer of some of the data. And then in soil ecology, we have people actually building the sensor instruments that are depending on the soil science data for their own work. So they're engineers. So another kind of community. 1 minute? Okay. So sharing conventions, by request only, no repositories in the first two. Most is post-publication, but some unpublished data. Individual data components will be required for reuse. So we have these packages have to be used separately by eventually once they're in the repository. And then at present, literature and conference-based sharing relationships are about all that exist across all three. So they share with people that they know or they meet at conferences or people who get interested in their data at conferences. Sometimes they're tracing back through the literature, but it's really not as common as you might think. Okay, and so I'll just say quickly, we do have a multifaceted education program starting with our master's in biological informatics. It started in 2006. We were trying to get people trained to be curation and information specialists on research teams. Then through two very wonderful grants we got from IMLS, we started a science data curation master's concentration in 2006, and then Alan started the humanities one in 2008. And then for in-service professional development, we've had, this past May was our third Summer Institute of Data Curation. So we did science, humanities, and now we're starting more specialized ones. We did earth science this past May. Okay, I'm probably one over, but that's it.
And we've
already had a plug for the Digital Curation Conference.
Well, now that doesn't do any harm.